Good morning and welcome to our Trinity Sunday service. No matter where you are, it is wonderful to have you joining us this morning. Whether you're regular at St Mark's or just joining us for our online services, I pray that all of you are keeping well and safe, and hopefully you've been able to enjoy the wonderful weather that we've been having. It's still rather strange worshipping together over the internet instead of in person. Hopefully soon, but not too soon, we will be able to join together in our churches. In the meantime, we are so lucky that we have amazing technology and wonderful people behind the scenes putting together our services. I just want to thank you guys all very much for all you do. So, let us begin our service this morning with a prayer. Please feel free to join in with the words in bold. We come from scattered lives to meet with God. Let us recognise his presence with us. As God's people we have gathered, let us worship him together. Even though we are scattered at the moment, that doesn't stop us worshipping God together. And with that in mind, let's have our first song of worship this morning. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
As we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong
the defender of glory.
Isn't it amazing that no matter what is going on with us and in the world, that God is there, right at the centre? He doesn't abandon us. He doesn't fade away into the distance. He doesn't run out of strength. He is always there to defend us all, no matter what. And he lifts us up so that we can come face to face with him in our daily lives. At the moment, for me, that is just amazing, knowing that all this turmoil with COVID-19, God is there, right in the middle of it all, holding us and supporting us. Now, unfortunately, our lives are often so full to bursting point. We make mistakes. We don't put God first. However, that does not matter, as we have the most amazing, wonderful and forgiving God who wipes the slate clean every time we turn to him. So now, let's take a moment to pause and bring to mind all those things we have done wrong. Father, when our worship has been more about us than about you, Lord, have mercy. When our songs have ignored the pain of your broken body on earth, Christ, have mercy. When our services have been more of an escape for us than good news to the poor, Lord, have mercy. Now let us hear the good news of the gospel. May God forgive us our sins, cleanse us by the blood of Christ, and fill us with his Holy Spirit to lead lives of worship that bring his resurrection power to our broken world and inspire services of worship which reflect his heart for justice, mercy, and humility. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. It's Trinity Sunday. But what is that? Well, it's the very first Sunday after Pentecost. And it celebrates the fact that God is one in three. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We'll learn more about that later with Kim. Right now, we're going to go to our Bible readings. Our first reading comes from Isaiah chapter 40 and will be read by David. And our Gospel reading will be from Matthew 28 and will be read by Sarah. After those, we'll go straight into hearing what Kim has for us.
Our first reading comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 12 to 17, and also verses 27 to 31. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, or with the breadth of his hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in a basket, or weighed the mountains on scales and the hills in a balance? Who can fathom the Spirit of the Lord, or instruct the Lord as his counsellor? Whom did the Lord consult to enlighten him, and who taught him the right way? Who was it that taught him knowledge, or showed him the path of understanding. Surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales. He weighs the islands as though they were fine dust. Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Before him, all the nations are as nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. And continuing from verse 27, why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord? My cause is disregarded by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The gospel reading today is Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. The Great Commission. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always. Go to the very end of the age. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
As you can see, I've relocated to church today. I've got a few parish admin jobs to do, and I thought I'd make my recording here today. So, I don't know how many of you have been using Zoom for meeting up with friends or with family or for business meetings recently, but it's quite difficult to know how to finish them. Some people wave wildly, others just click end meeting and disappear abruptly, while others still linger on trying to chatter at the very end and catch up with people, a bit like a normal Sunday after church. And this made me think about endings and beginnings. Last week was the birth of the church when the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples at Pentecost, the very beginning of the church. Today we go back to an ending and a beginning, the ending of Jesus' ministry on earth and the launch of the messianic mission. Let's take another look at this short passage again and find out what Matthew is saying to us today. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. In these last five verses of Matthew's Gospel, he concludes his account of Jesus' mission, a mission that had started 3 years before when Jesus had left the wilderness. It says in Matthew 4, when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he withdrew to Galilee. Leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum, which was by the lake in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali. Matthew is making a couple of points here. Jesus' ministry is concluding where it started, where it began in Galilee. And this is significant. Matthew refers to Galilee as the Galilee of all nations, drawing in a link from the prophet Isaiah. Galilee was part of the northern kingdom and it had much more a diverse population. Matthew is demonstrating that God's kingdom is expanded to all those outside of the nation of Israel, to all people. And this theme of all runs throughout this passage. All authority. Jesus as God's son has authority over heaven and earth. All nations. All people are included. The good news is inclusive. All things, i.e. everything, obeying everything that Jesus has commanded. Now I know this is a big ask, and I'm very much a work in progress, and some days are better than others. All times, i.e. always, Jesus is with us always. We will not be abandoned. Jesus has given us the Holy Spirit. We are adopted in his family. Now, you may have spotted in the passage that some of the disciples doubted. And there's been various explanations for this. And some scholars have suggested that there were others present, in addition to the 11 disciples. And it was this group that doubted Jesus. However, the Greek here in this section doesn't suggest that at all. The words actually used are similar to those when Peter doubted when he walked on the water as he walked towards Jesus. In his commentary, R.T. France uses the word hesitant rather than doubt. He goes on to suggest that the disciples didn't quite know how to respond to Jesus. He is both the same and different from the man that they knew before. So today is Trinity Sunday, and whilst writing this sermon, I realised that in the last 3 years, I've either led or preached on Trinity Sunday. And I'm going to write a note to myself so that next year I add this date to my dates to avoid. It seems such a small word, doesn't it, Trinity? And so much has been written on it by learned theologians. And those of us that lead or preach find that in explaining it, we can end up committing a heresy or heresies, as there are more than one. Wayne Grudem, author of the huge tome that's called Systematic Theology, states that the doctrine of the Trinity is a mystery that we will never be able to understand fully. Now, you may remember that the last time I preached on Trinity Sunday, I played a video of Irish twins who take St. Patrick to task for using bad analogies. There is a link to it on the footnotes if you'd like to revisit it. In the video, St. Patrick bases his explanation on a large chunk of the Athanasian Creed, which incredibly, the twins seem to understand. Just a quick side note, the Athanasian Creed is long, 656 words to be precise, and it wasn't even written by Athanasius. If you want to have a go at reading it, there's also a link to that on the footnotes too. So instead, I searched out for something different and came across a blog post by Michael Roberts, who very succinctly gave a summary of the Trinity in 3 words and 10 letters. Over, with, in. Firstly, God is Father and Creator over us. Secondly, God is with us in Jesus, who lived as a human, died and rose again. Finally, God is in us as the Holy Spirit leads and guides us. Now, this may seem much too simple, but I hope it makes a little sense of a complex concept. The creed I mentioned earlier doesn't make sense of it at all. Going back to today's scripture, we find that the words Jesus spoke to his disciples galvanized them into action. This was a moment of ending, but also one of beginning. These words launched the messianic mission. Jesus commissions his disciples, a group that didn't always understand him, a group that had made mistakes and argued amongst themselves. They had been scared and went into hiding at his crucifixion. One of them had denied him. Another needed to see him to believe in his resurrection. They were ordinary people who had both worshipped and doubted at the same time. They became a transformed community of believers who lived and died for their faith. The Holy Spirit in them changed everything in their lives. This passage is often subtitled as the Great Commission. And there is an imperative here to make disciples and not just proclaim the good news. Now, this might seem quite difficult at the moment. We're not meeting in the same ways as we used to, and it's going to be a while before we can do so again. We are stuck in the middle of an ending of the pre-pandemic world and the beginning of the post-pandemic world. This gap is sometimes called liminal space, a place between one point and the next, the feeling of just being on the verge of something. Our mission in this in-between liminal space is to look for the signs of God's kingdom at work, to be attuned to see the Holy Spirit working in all people's lives, not just those we know to be Christians, to be ready to join in with what the Holy Spirit is doing, to pray and reassure all those who are feeling anxious at this time. Our work is to continue what the disciples were commissioned to do by Jesus 2,000 years ago on an unknown mountain in Galilee, when heaven and earth met, and offer hope to others of a new beginning. Shall we pray together? And this prayer is on the resource sheet and is written by Sam Hargreaves from Engage Worship. Jesus, we worship you, and sometimes we doubt. Yet we know all authority is yours. So you call us to go to all nations, to make disciples, to continue your mission. You call us to announce your kingdom, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cast out demons. You call us to baptize in your name. You are Father, you are Son, you are the Holy Spirit. We will follow, we will obey, and teach all you have commanded. For you are with us always, day after day, year after year, to the very end of the age. Amen.
Shall we pray together? Loving Heavenly Father, you taught us to pray at all times and in all circumstances, but sometimes we find it difficult to draw our thoughts together, and the jumble of worries and problems rattle around in our heads until we can only say, Father, help us. But you know everything about our lives. You see into our very hearts. So help us now to just breathe in your Holy Spirit and offer all our concerns to you. Lord, you created us to be sociable people, not to live our lives in isolation. So this strange time has been difficult for us all, as we have been separated from family and friends. But help us to remember especially those who have lost loved ones during this time, without having the opportunity of a comforting touch or word of goodbye. But we thank you, Father, for those dedicated professionals within our health service, the nurses, doctors, and carers, who, despite the weariness of long shifts and stressful situations, still took the time to show compassion and love in our absence. As we think of our health service, we pray that we will not forget the sacrifices made not only by them, but by all frontline workers, some of whom put themselves and their families at risk to continue to serve and provide for us. Help us to have a greater appreciation of them all and never to take them for granted. And as we have gained a greater understanding of our own vulnerability, we ask that we will continue to maintain the respect for the well-being and protection of those around us when we return to a new normal. As small adjustments to our present situation are made, we pray that there will be no repercussions or increases in infections. We think especially of our younger children returning to school, and we ask your protection, Lord, over them and over the staff and support workers involved in organising a very different way of teaching. Help them to adjust and enjoy being back with friends while observing the rules to keep them safe. Give the staff the energy they will need to contain the exuberance of these little ones while encouraging learning. Lord of all wisdom, we ask you to be with all those world leaders and decision makers who have had to deal with this pandemic, which has swept through nations, without any previous knowledge of the virus. We know that mistakes may have been made, but we hope that we have learned much from this experience and that we will have gleaned more understanding for future situations. Lord, be with those working in scientific fields who are striving to develop and test vaccines to control this outbreak and hopefully to combat future outbreaks. And we know, Father, there will be those who will seek to apportion blame or score political points, but help us to continue to pull together as we did at the outset and move forward as a stronger, wiser, and more caring people. Dear Lord, we pray for your church worldwide and especially for the church family of St. Mark's. Thank you for Nicola and all those who have been holding us together through the use of modern technology, providing our services while we are still unable to meet, and for all who have been caring remotely for us by phone or email. We are grateful for the new sense of community which has been generated by offers of help for those self-isolating, and for a new awareness of the needs of those around us. Lord, we are so privileged to live in such a wonderful environment with access to garden space, and for those who are physically able, to the glorious countryside within walking distance of our homes. For many of us, the beautiful weather has enabled us to appreciate your amazing creation, Lord, and as the season has changed from spring to summer, we have been blessed with a beauty of new life in the plants and trees and the joy of birdsong in the air, lifting our hearts and instilling fresh hope at this difficult time. Finally, Father, we give you thanks for those who have quietly cared for our church building and grounds while we have been unable to gather there. And we long for the time when we can be together once more, to worship and praise your holy name. But give us the patience meantime to be still and know that you are God. Amen. And shall we now join in the prayer that Jesus taught us? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Kim, for bringing us God's word this morning. Thank you also to David and Sarah for your readings, and Sandra for the prayers. All that is left now for me to do is to wish you all the best for the coming week and to remind you that Nicola, our vicar, is always available if you need any help. Just get in touch through the church office. Just to remind you, even though our church buildings are actually closed at the moment, the church itself isn't, because we are the church. We're going to have our final blessing and then our final song, which is Holy, Holy, Holy Lord God Almighty. So, for our blessing. God of power, may the boldness of your spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your spirit lead us. May the gifts of your spirit equip us to serve and worship you. Now and always. Amen.